He's the senior scholar in residence at the Holocaust Study Center in Sonoma State. He's the founding director of the Holocaust Study Center at Sonoma State. I doubt whether we would have a Holocaust Study Center if it wasn't for Dr. Steiner's efforts. He's got quite a long list of himself, a resident of Theresienstadt at one time. I give you Dr. Steiner.
Thank you very much for your very kind introduction, which I may or may not deserve, depending on the perspective. Now, what I'd like to somehow prepare you for is that the type of information I have, I just simply can't give you off the cuff. Some of that I have to read, and that may be a little bit cumbersome, not only for you, but certainly also for myself. This is a type of information which I had to put together, in some sort of a tedious way by way of research and looking at numerous books and just simply pick out the most important information. And I can't give you all of it because it would be too heavy. And because your retention span may be slightly lower than that of students 20 years ago, I have to take that into consideration. Also, I'd like to have a little bit of time left once you are through with me, or vice versa, to have question and answer period, because there may be a lot of questions, at least I would hope so. Other than that, I can see that many people are still on vacation because there are kind of empty spaces here. But that's not one of our problems, because we are here, right? We are here. Let me just preface what I want to say, actually the message which I have for you. The important thing for us to realize is that there is a confusion among scholars as well as survivors in terms of what to do with the experience of us and how to use that to build upon and interpret. And in some of the sections I already mentioned the fact that to dwell on the dreadful, the awful, the terrible, terrible, horrible experience is not a solution because it doesn't tell us what we can learn from it other than it was horrible. And that simply is not enough. And therefore we need to use that type of information and beyond the experiential one and interpret what can be interpreted. That will be limited to be sure, but not as limited as some people advocate. And I think there is very much we can learn, and I've done it in a way which was important to me, going back to the perpetrators and giving them questionnaires to fill out and interviews which have been taped and so forth in order to get an insight into how people can really perpetrate these dreadful things on people who were by large, totally innocent. And that is something which we need to prevent in the future. And that is the reason why I'm still in the Holocaust business, so to speak. There's big business also for so many people. And that's why I continue to do as long as I can before I totally fall apart and won't be able to function without some degree of senility. I'm trying to be funny in case you don't. Didn't get the point. But that's all right, but I'm serious about the senility. So just start with what I've said and emphasize, that experience, emotions, and horror by itself is a motivator, but not an explainer, if I can put it in this way. It doesn't explain anything. It only tells us the terrible, terrible things humans can do to each other. Right, so let me start, having said that, let me start with the first graph, which I think will elucidate some of what I've said heretofore. Now, with sounding of reflection, sweat and blood, I've come up with this, which to my mind is a fair explanation, or helps you towards a better explanation, a better understanding of what we are going to talk about here. And I'm trying to find my my pointer, but I just, for some reason, not in my pocket. So let me just start with ideology. Now, first of all, we need to understand that all the people who are susceptible to ideology are in a state of flux. In other words, they have experienced frustrated expectations. And I call it frustrated expectations because the present situation in which they find themselves is highly unsatisfactory. In other words, they will not be able to continue in their accustomed lifestyle. And therefore, they will be very dissatisfied, discontented. Because discontented. A person who is charismatic has a very special appeal, uncommon appeal, like Hitler certainly had, like Mussolini had, and like some other charismatic demagogues had, will come out with very simplistic explanation and justify their ideology and make it very palatable to them, very palatable to them. So that these people will say, my God, has a very simple solution and is willing to lead us out of a situation which has become increasingly unbearable. All right? So therefore, they will jump to the on the bandwagon of that particular demagogue, that particular charismatic individual who comes with an ideology and gives them hope, promises, emphasis. Hope and promises. Hitler was exactly the person who could do it. He could hold the masses. So the next one is identification, derogation, not deprogation, that's a typo, derogation of potential outputs. So because we are in a bad shape, you have witnessed it already in certain situations in which you may have found yourself, you try to find scapegoats for something where you can put your blame on. Put the blame on them and say, they are responsible for my misfortune, for my discontent. And therefore, anyone who says, well, you are okay, but the other ones are responsible for unhappiness and discontent, and there are the badniks, what I call the badniks. You know what I'm saying, badniks, bad people. All right, and most of that, and invariably, any of the ideology of this kind, which not only has a scapegoat to put the blame on, but also will have a very strong, strong content of prejudice and stereotyping. Just think in terms of minorities in the United States throughout the ages. Then this stereotyping and prejudice will also be responsible for the devaluation and dehumanization of the outgroups, namely they become increasingly out, who are being targeted and stereotyped. And responded to with prejudice. Then you have the members of outgroups cast into roles simply because usually the people who become victims are more powerless. They are powerless. The powerful pick on the powerless because they can't defend themselves too well, and therefore they are a very typical target for people with this type of ideology and with this type of stereotyping and prejudice. So they are cast into the role. The powerful cast the less powerful into a role. Now, the further they are cast into a role and dehumanized, the greater becomes the social distance between the in-group, the powerful, and the powerless. So if they are so far away from the in-group that people don't relate to them, don't care about them, lost all concern for them, then the dangerous situation has come in which they be and that mistreated, and that can escalate into genocide. All right, so the degree of ideological identification, concern, and compassion with out-group members can be measured by social distance. And the greater the social distance, the less I care about them. Now let's take, for example, what happens in the world, about genocides all over the place in this world today. And the chances are that if you're really nice, you may send some of the organizations some money in order to help these unfortunates, but the chances also are that you won't lose any night's sleep over them. And you also don't lose any night's sleep over those people to whom you don't relate, which may include some minority in this very country, in this very society. All right, so then you have discrimination, aggression, escalation of violence directed against outgroups, in extreme cases, extermination and genocide. You get a smattering of that in the latest sort of news in the United States in Cincinnati. Some of you may have followed what is happening there. And a few people, they say, well, how terrible, but then they go and fall asleep or eat nicely and forget about it. So that is exactly what we need to learn to stand up to be counted. And I keep on saying that, stand up to be counted, because knowledge by itself is not going to change anything. We have to apply. All right. So then you have the final thing, reduction of cognitive dissonance. That is to say, with the help of ideology, you can justify worst crimes against humanity. Crimes against humanity can be justified with the help of ideology, which will say, well, you know, we do it because it is justified. They deserve it. Okay, so then you have the society in this sort of circle, and then you can see that the society expulsion from accepted members of society takes place when we go through all these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then the tragedy can happen if we don't stop it in time. Do I make myself clear? I mean, perfectly clear. All right. Let me just
individual and group. What is it? Collective. So it should be collective. Yeah, it is group collective. All right. Resistance, which is partisan activity, armed uprising, revolts. We'll be talking in greater specifics. Assassination,
sabotage, fighting in Allied forces, combat units, underground resistance against the aggressor. And then you have unarmed resistance, illegal meeting gatherings, posting and distribution of anti-Nazi literature, living illegally underground as submarines or U-boats. I have an uncle in Austria who was a U-boat, and he disappeared and survived the war because of support by some of the people who were sympathetic to his plight. And that is very important. To what extent do you find people who will be willing to support you at great risk? And we've talked about that, and some other speakers talked about it, so we don't have to belabor that. So then rescuers, these are the rescuers, altruists, saving the lives of persecuted, and in very specific cases, diplomats, military people, public officials, police, and what have you. So that all took place outside the camps. Inside the camps, you have active resistance, uprising and revolts in ghettos, and to some extent also concentration camps. The one known I will talk about was in Auschwitz-Birkenau, that is Auschwitz II. Sabotage, I was very much involved with that in my work at the slave labor camp. Escaping from the camp, which was deadly for reasons which I will discuss. I hope you'll have enough time for that. Organizing, taking vital material from SS holdings or dead inmates. Organizing for all practical purposes was stealing. And it was euphemized and entitled organizing. It's kind of a nicer word than, God, you are stealing. So then you had illegal meetings with fellow inmates to develop survival resistance strategies, making contact with the outside world to inform and or ask for support. That's what I've done very actively with a great deal of success, writing letters and also informing people that I was in the purgatory. And I use the Latin word of purgatory, purgatorio. And that was something which people understood. Now, fortunately, the SS people who read the mail did not understand that. They didn't understand the meaning of it simply because they're not that fully educated. So then you have passive resistance, ideological resistance, religious, philosophical, and one is willing to put into practice. In the camp, which will give you some strength, will give you some, help you to find meaning in this horror, which is exceedingly difficult. And without that, you'll find it very difficult to survive, simply because you can't find meaning in this dreadful situation. The chances are that psycho-emotionally you simply did not keep up or were not able to develop the degree of resistance which would have saved your life, at least for a moment, for a day, for an hour, for a month, and maybe for a year. So that took place having a belief, religious. Then we talk about psychological resistance, that is to say, I understood that these people tried to kill me or wipe me out, and some other groups of people who are similarly situated, but I said, I'm not going to let them do it. And the younger you were, the better chances you had to resist in every of these various alternatives, or all of them. So then cultural, educational, and artistic activity was exceedingly important in order to help you to transcend the terrible reality of every day. The fifth one is combination of all the above, which is of course an ideal case, very few people were able to achieve. And then the last category, which I think is exceedingly important, has not been discussed in Holocaust literature, but I felt it very acutely when I was in the cattle wagon situation, the trip to Dachau, from Reichenbach to Dachau. Then I felt totally hopeless. All the 1 to 5 were virtually distant. And I said, I don't have a prayer. I can't possibly survive that ordeal. It's just impossible, unrealistic. And therefore, I lost all hope. But then, interestingly, the biological drive of self-preservation took over. And I was driven, without actually understanding. On one hand, I don't have a chance, I don't have a prayer. On the other hand, the biological drive of self-preservation, as I call it, took over and pushed me to survive, to do all I could in time and space in order to survive. All right. So if you have any questions later, be sure that anything I say, you put down some notes and so that we can have a dialogue which will perhaps elucidate some of the things which I some of the things which I've said.
I think that's all we have time for. I have some other ones, but I don't think we have time for.
So let me continue. To foster, and I am going to read, unfortunately, get through it as fast as I possibly can, and I hope you will excuse that. To foster a better understanding of resistance under Nazi totalitarian rule, one needs to be aware of the fact that the regime, the Nazi regime, was firmly based on a police state. And that is something which most people here in the United States in a democracy have a problem to really realize. Because you don't understand that in your house, wherever you live, in an apartment house and all that, you've got a confidence man who will tell on you, and that person is then responsible, a block person who is responsible to a district person and all that. So any move you make is virtually controlled. You can't move from one place to another without permission and without going to the police. Tell them about the change of your address. So any move you make is virtually controlled. One of the major reasons which made racial, ethnic, and religious persecution a reality, that is precisely the regime was firmly posited on a police state. First of all, a creed of any kind deemed superior or inferior is not racially based. Let me exemplify. One. There are Christians, Jews, Mohammedans, Buddhists, and many others of all races and ethnic backgrounds. Jesus Christ was a Jew, and so were his disciples. And the first Christians were Jews, the first followers of Jesus Christ, Jews. So what we have here at the bottom of the conflict is ignorance, prejudice, intolerance, stereotyping, toward different persuasions and beliefs. We also need to recognize that a belief is a myth system, something we do not know for a fact and for which we have no tangible evidence. That is why we believe something we don't know. If I know something and can prove it, I don't need to believe it. Under National Socialism, the people were told to believe that persons who were not of Aryan, that is Nordic background, were allegedly of lesser value because of their genetic makeup, which supposedly caused them to have undesirable, even criminal characteristics. This belief was propped by Nazi leaders to be a fact. It was sold as a fact. but without any sort of proof which would have been watertight. An absolute and became in 1935 236 law known as the Nuremberg Racial Laws. This law divided people into A, Nordic and superior master race on one hand, and subhumans on the other, and you know that all, but I want to repeat it to make it absolutely sure that it drives home. The Jews, Gypsies, and Slavs were classified as subhumans, the Jews foremost of all. So it stands to reason that in Nazi-occupied countries, and now comes the new stuff which you don't know, and most of the people, be granted it read that show for reasons which escape me, that in countries where hatred against the Jews was weak or even non-existent, resistance against persecution of the Jews was the strongest. In Nazi-occupied countries where anti-Judaism already existed prior to the German occupation or political domination, support for Nazi persecution and for genocidal measures, I should say, was very strong. The most horrible atrocities committed by Nazis and their collaborators occurred in the eastern regions of Europe. And that's a very, very strong tendency. Exceptions to the rule for sure. Tendency was when once you were there in the eastern regions of Europe, sent there by way of deportation or some other reasons, the chances are that you did not survive. Period. And those who survived are, for all practical purposes, of course, exceptions to the rule. So especially in the years, and learning about the years of 1941 and 42, but also, of course, in 1943 and 44, but that came in waves. But then petered off a little bit, particularly in 44. Why? Because people did not want to kill the people who could have been killed by slave labor. So it was much more useful at this point to use people who heretofore were exterminated to kill in slave labor camps. So the conditions making resistance possible nevertheless varied in every Nazi-occupied country and even in Germany itself. These conditions depended on numerous factors such as geopolitics, the attitude of the population toward National Socialist ideology and its racist core, the will to resist, how well different segments of a society were integrated in that particular society, and so on. In countries like Denmark, Finland, to a lesser extent Bulgaria and Italy, and even France, there existed a strong support system aiding and rescuing Jews because they were so well integrated, and it, in contrast, as I said before, to countries of East Europe, where the Jews were socially unintegrated, isolated, and especially hated. Now, I might also add for your understanding is the fact that even though a government may have been pro-Nazi because of reasons of expediency, did not turn against the Jews, and that was, of course, a blessing. Because then you had people who were rescuers in that country. The speed and well-organized extent of Nazi persecution was also an important factor which needs to be taken into account and not underrated. We find a considerable gradation between Eastern and Eastern Nazi-occupied regions, the farther in the east, the swifter, more cruel and numerous the destruction of the Jews and Gypsies became. Furthermore, there were also the topographical differences which played an important role in the highly industrialized parts of Western Europe, Nazi-occupied Europe. There were no partisans who would operate densely wooded areas because they did not exist. Examples are Belgium, Holland, France, and Italy. But instead of partisans, there existed anti-fascist urban guerrillas. Guerrillas, and don't confuse that with monkeys. Not funny. Well, okay, it's all right. So I'll ask myself if you know reason to. Anyway, so there's a difference because of people's guerrilla is not something which is in everyone's vocabulary. That's why I'm just mentioning that. Whom Jewish resistors were joining. Unlike in the West, such as Poland, Ukraine, and Russia, where there are vast areas of dense woods and where Jewish partisans could establish themselves and were fight with success, that was a different situation again. So there, in one area, the eastern parts, you had partisans, and in the west, you had guerrillas. However, the population's attitude towards Jews in these areas was very negative. Whoever succeeded to escape from ghettos and join the partisans was in a constant danger to be denounced, even killed by the indigenous population. Similar condition existed in Baltic countries, Lithuania, Latvia, and Estonia, where the populace was very anti-Jewish and pro-Nazi. Let me give you now select but specific examples. Let's start with Belgium. It was the first country where extermination tempo began to slow down. Eichmann's executioners could report only partial success to Berlin of the 52,000 Jews living in Belgium. 24,000 were murdered, but very few Jews possessing Belgian nationality were handed over to the death factories in the east. Even the Nazi puppet government in Vichy, France, refused to assist the final solution, although Pierre Laval, the head of the government, did not yet know that murder was the purpose of Jewish resettlement in the east. Even so, he barred the way to the SS hunters. In the provinces of France, Eichmann's death wagons remained empty because the French gendarmerie sabotaged Eichmann's program, on whose cooperation he had to rely. The gendarmes produced only 150 victims to begin with, who were stateless Jews. Stateless Jews, and that comes again in terms of social distance. If you're not one of us, then we don't feel it. That's very, very important. So if you are stateless someplace, and I used to be stateless when I skipped the communist Czechoslovakia, so I had just a piece of paper, no one wanted to let me in. It was very difficult for me to get visas. And simply because I felt, well, this person doesn't have a stable background, and we don't want to be responsible for him and pay his bills. So, and also, therefore, there was a tremendous social distance which made it very difficult for me to get into certain countries and which didn't want people like myself who did not have a citizenship. I've lost my Czech citizenship when I skipped the country, by the way, just to mention. The Italian army, for example, refused to take action against Jews. The chief of the Italian general staff told a Nazi leader anti-Jewish excesses are not compatible with the honor of the Italian army. a sentiment one would have wished to hear from the mouth of a German general. Now let me give you one example here which I tested this precisely. So I interviewed a person who was an SS general and had a long-standing relationship with him in terms of dialogues and interviews and exchange of information and interests. So I've asked him, he was a the last position, he was an army commander of an army. And so I said, you obviously know what happened behind the battleground, namely what the Einsatzgruppen and Einsatzkommandos did to minorities, particularly the Jews. And with your view, I think you think you probably would not have agreed with that. And so what did you do about it? And he said, well, you know, I was preoccupied with the survival of my troops. I didn't have time to care for what happened behind the battleground. And that was a very interesting and plausible explanation, but to me it was not persuasive, and we can talk about it and said, well, you know, you have to set priorities. And I know that he did not agree with what the Einsatz commandos did to the Jews behind the lines. So, in Greece, for example, General Geloso, commanding the Italian Second Army, refused to see the bearing of the Star of David in his occupied areas and in Athens, that was Greece. He posted a guard at the synagogue and the Jewish community center to deter a Greek anti-Semitic organization from instigating anti-Jewish riots. In Salonika, which was German-occupied, also German-occupied, which was not also German-occupied, the Italian consulate saved hundreds of Jews, granting them Italian nationality. In February 1943, the police chief of Lens, France, placed 300 Jews in an internment camp for subsequent transport to Auschwitz. An Italian general promptly compelled him to release them. Early in March, the French gendarmerie arrested a number of Jews in the Italian zone, but Italians prevented that from being that they were being carried off to German destruction camps. Italian troops surrounded the gendarmerie barracks in Annecy until the arrested were released. The capitulation of Italy in the summer of 1943 deprived the French Jews of their Italian protectors. However, the humanity of the Italian generals had assisted 80% of the 300,000 Jews of France to escape the extermination camps. In April 1943, King Boris XIV to 17th October 43, which turned out to be rather unsuccessful, out of 8,000 Roman Jews, only 1,259 could be found and deported. SS Police Lieutenant Colonel Herbert Kepler, in charge of the operation, wired on October 17th to Berlin, attempts to drag police officers away from Jews, end of quote. And that was in this type of style, a telegram, a cable. A remarkable outcome, indeed, if you just consider that as an act the Italian population. Now let us turn to the case of Finland. In Finland, by the way, were 2,000 troops, not a very high number. In July 1942, Hitler was demanding surrender of Finland's Jews. On July 29th, Himmler flew to Helsinki to negotiate Hitler's request. However, the Finns employed clever strategies, and at the end, after a repeated visit on September 8th, All right, so that is very interesting because, again, bringing into focus the social distance, they felt very close to their own Finnish Jews, but not that close to the non-Finnish Jews who lived in Finland, which would have prevented them to hand them over to the SS. Which they did. And recently, by the way, and that's how I found out about it, they apologized. Just now, recently. So they waited for a long time. All right. So let me now turn to German resistance, which is very interesting and pretty much unknown. A man called Dr. Bernhard Lösner, a counselor in the Interior Ministry, attempted to save two fringe categories of German mixed Jews whose fate had not yet been decided, namely the so-called 107,000 half-castes Mischlinge mixed Jews, namely who had at least two grandparents who were non-Jewish, all right? They're Mischling. So in a laborious conference with the Reich Security Main Office, the most powerful main office in charge of security in Germany and responsible for the treatment, deportation, and industrial killing of Jews, Lösner and his superior state secretary in the Reich Ministry, Ministry of Interior, a man called Dr. Wilhelm Stuckart, took refuge in a last death proposal to save these half-castes by suggesting sterilization instead of extermination so that they would not propagate, that they simply would multiply if you sterilize them. The Stuckart-Lösner proposed Himmler in a weak moment. Himmler, with Hitler's agreement, forbade liquidation, and the majority of the Mischlinge, mixed Jews, were thus saved. Now, what is very important in this context is that Dr. Stuckart, who also was, by the way, general in the SS, honorary general in the SS, and therefore had a great deal of clout, beforehand that sterilization half-caste was in fact something which he knew was impracticable. It couldn't be done under the circumstances. It was simply impossible. The most expensive and well-known rescue efforts, as you have learned, took place in Denmark, where SS Lieutenant General and Reichsplenipotentiary in Copenhagen, Dr. Werner Best, played an active part in sabotage extermination of a Danish Jewry. As soon as he heard the date of the deportation, Werner Best let his shipping expert, George Ferdinand Duckwitz, into the picture and told him to warn the Jews. On September 27, Duckwitz met with Danish resistance leaders in Copenhagen and asked them to alert the leaders of the Danish Jewish community. By grapevine, the word went around through the synagogues and Jewish homes. The Jews went into hiding, and then in one of the most remarkable rescue operations of World War II, which a nation has undertaken to rescue a Jewish minority, they were shipped by Danish, as you have heard before in the lecture of Knut, across the Kattegat, as they call it, Kattegat, to safety into Sweden. Out of 5,600 Jews, only 477 were transported to Theresienstadt, And I have defended one of the members who was just about my age in Theresienstadt, and strangely, was the only one I can remember who was released with his entire family and shipped to Sweden. That is something which is unheard of, because I know of no case in literature or by word of mouth that this was possible, to be released from Theresienstadt. And the reason is, of course, because if you release people like that from Theresienstadt, they would have told about the conditions and informed the international public about what is taking place there. And that, of course, the Nazis didn't want to have. And another important thing which I'd like to mention in this connection is that the interesting thing that the extermination, the Jewish genocide, gypsies and all that, was top secret. Now, if the German people would have agreed to such a measure, they could have made it public. But they didn't, and that is something to think about. Because there are some advocates saying that all the Germans were such and such, and all anti-Semitic, and they all supported genocide and what have you. And it's really not true. Because if that had been the case, Himmler would have come into the open and say, hey, you know, I'm doing you a favor, terrific thing, we are killing all the German Jews. But he didn't do it. He kept it top secret. Okay. So let us turn now into resistance in the camps. In order to survive in any type of camp, passive or preferably active resistance was absolutely essential. However, resistance by itself was not a guarantee of survival by any means, because of multitude of other factors such as age, health, presence of the ability to become camp-wise, you know, the expression being street-wise, but there is something also which I've developed a term for, which I've learned from Steve, means camp-wise. And it just so happens, the younger you were, the more alert you were, the better chance you had to develop this sort of camp wisdom. I certainly have, because otherwise I wouldn't be standing in front of you. And that's a bloody fact. And I mean a bloody effect, more bloody than effect, both actually. So the ability to adjust to extreme situations, to be the first to avoid danger, or when standing in line for soup, food, and soup was the main fare in the camps in general, to be one of the last, but not quite the last, in order to be served more solids, such as turnip, potatoes, and the like. There was nothing much better there. I remember it was a feast which I'll never forget in my experience, one Sunday, which was, I think, around Christmas. We received a soup with peas and some meat in it. It was a feast. It was an unbelievable feast. I'll never forget that. It made all the difference. We were overjoyed. It was just like if you would have won $1 million. That's how it felt. And perhaps even more so. So those people who were not camp-wise, they did know that, and therefore they received, instead of some more solid, substantive little bit of food, because turnips are virtually valueless as far as calories are concerned, they received merely a soup without calories, and which was primarily without nutrition and water, and tasted, of course, something which you would say dish water. So, to survive, one needed to be alert when one encountered an inmate functioning capo, and you've heard of capos, the fossiers, and even more so an SS guard, not to stay in the inmate infirmary for too long in order to avoid being sent to the gas chamber. And that happened to me also. I've had some friends who happened to be. So if he had not done that, I would have been a goner. And if you didn't have the contacts, as I've had, fortunately, which not most people didn't have like that, you know, actually he was the head doctor and on very good terms with Mengele. And if I haven't had this sort of person to inform and support me with medication, but and information, I certainly would, again, as I said before, wouldn't stand in front of you here. Would stand in front of some other existence, perhaps. So, so what also I've mentioned before is to organize. You needed to learn to organize and not organize from fellow inmates, because that was deadly. Because if you were caught and all that, and you also felt morally responsible not to want to do that because they were your own people. So you tried to avoid to do that. But if you were caught stealing from a fellow inmate, you were clobbered to death. And I've seen it. I've seen it. I witnessed it. So organizing was stealing what you could, but not from fellow inmates, as I said. Commit acts of sabotage was another thing, whenever possible, without being caught. Stay as clean as possible to avoid lice, bed bugs, and other vermin. And of course, germs, bacteria, viruses, which, however, was actually next to impossible, because to avoid that, that was under the conditions virtually impossible. And these are just a few examples. Now, older people, that is those over 30 or 35, turned, if they were unable to supplement their exceedingly meager food rations, were subject to aging very quickly, quick aging, and looked more like 50 or 60, and they were 30 or 35. And because of this aging process, in the camp, which, by the way, after the camp was again reversed, by the way, they became vulnerable to infections, diseases, and more often lost the ability to react, respond swiftly, and of course to work. And then they were doomed, absolutely doomed. In camp lingo, they were called Muslim men. In this state, their lifespan lasted about 3 weeks at the most. And I've seen these people. If you looked at them, they had glazed eyes and walked properly, no longer were able to respond rationally, and just simply were walking like virtually dead men already, almost dead men. And their lifespan was very, very short then, after they were in that state. When inmates were rounded up by the SS to be sent to the chamber, there was nothing one could do except to commit suicide. And that is something which was which you couldn't avoid. If you were rounded up to be sent to the gas chamber, there was no way to escape from it. Absolutely not. Unless, and I had a friend, very close friend, I've discussed it with Myrna, a man called Freddy Hirsch, a German fellow whom I met in Prague. He moved from Germany to Czechoslovakia, which at that time was still democratic, but later on, of course, was occupied by the Nazis. And he did not want the Germans to kill him because he felt that he's not going to give them that pleasure, and committed suicide before. So, to be rounded up, and once you were rounded up, there was nothing, virtually nothing you could do in order to save your life. So I have virtually seen it all, what I have listed here during these years, the 3 years of my camp life and existence in hell. So let me talk about what historic event in the existence of Nazi camps took place on October 6, 1944 in Auschwitz II. Auschwitz II was Birkenau, during which 853 inmates and 70 SS were killed. Included among the latter were an SS first lieutenant, 70 non-commissioned men, and 5th SS privates first class. And it goes without saying that all, and I mean all the people were connected and participated in the uprising were killed without exception. They were all shot, not sent to the gas chamber, but they were all shot. Now the most well-known resistance, of course, the heroic uprising in the Warsaw ghetto of April 19, 1943, to May 16, but which also continued to a later day, talking 1943, as response to its liquidation by military forces made up of 2,000 soldiers, officers of the Waffen-SS, that is to say the combat SS, 3 detachments of the Wehrmacht armed forces, 2 battalions of the German police, that is 234 soldiers and officers, approximately 360 soldiers and officers of the Polish police, 35 members of the security, a battalion of so-called Askari, that is Ukrainian and led fascist soldiers of auxiliary formation of the SS, which made up 337 enlisted men and officers. Altogether, German forces numbered 2,842 plus an additional 7,000 SS men and gendarmes who were brought into Warsaw in case the ghetto revolt should spread to the Polish side, out of the ghetto into the Polish side of Warsaw. At the outbreak of the uprising, the Jewish fighting organization consisted of about 600 organized fighters and the military association and the Teamsters groups combined numbered about 400, only 400 people. So you had about, in total, about 1,000 people against this unbelievable army of Nazis. However, the number of the participants in the uprising was much larger. Thousands of Jews of various backgrounds spontaneously formed bunker groups, bought weapons, and offered active resistance. There were also others engaged in passive by large. The Polish military historian and former member of the Polish Army General Staff, Major General Jerzy Kirchmeier, wrote, and I'm quoting, "Warsaw ghetto fell after a heroic fight, but the idea of armed struggle in the name which the insurgents died reached beyond the ghetto walls, survived and endured until victory. The momentary success of the insurgents toppled the Germans from their pedestal of omnipotence and proved the Poles the effect, proved to the effectiveness of armed resistance. Yet the vast majority, as I said before, of the Jews or Jewish resistors were killed. Uri Sul, a man called Uri Sul, in his essay, Underground Assignment, Auschwitz, writes, our most important task was to inform the outside world, and they, and I'm quoting that, the outside world, that's my addition, by letters or reports that was happening, what was happening in Auschwitz, the enormous gassings, these forms of killing generally were not believed even by those who for many years fought in illegal movements against Hitler and were familiar with endless cruelties of the Nazis. And let me tell you that this is something also I did in my letters, which I was permitted to write from Auschwitz-Birkenau. I did all I could in order to, between the lines, to inform the people to whom I wrote what was going on. And usually using a language which I hoped, or I thought and hoped, that Germans could not understand, the Nazis, who read, of course, every, and these were cards, but they're not letters in the real sense of the word, but they're just like correspondence cards. Now let me move to Treblinka, and that we still can do. In Treblinka was the second largest extermination camp after Auschwitz. 800,000 Jews perished. And we talk about figures. You simply can't take them too seriously because they are approximations. They are approximations because no one knows the exact numbers. Also not how many Jews altogether died. And some people say 4,500,000 or 600,000. And what is normally claimed 6 million is the highest figure. With which I disagree, because I've read all the various statistics and even interviewed a SS registrar of Auschwitz-Birkenau, who told me very, very, and he was an expert because that was his job. And he said, well, you know, at the most, 1.5 million, at the most, you know, quote unquote, 1 million in one camp, within the shortest possible time, can you imagine? Imagine, 1.5 million. San Francisco doesn't have that population. And that's why I say, what we are doing here is something which needs to be taken very seriously, because once it happened, merely because it's past doesn't mean that it won't happen here, but in the future. And if you don't wake up and listen to what we are doing here, you've lost a tremendous opportunity. And maybe, hopefully, the penny will drop maybe later on. And in so many cases it has, because I've had lots of people who I meet in the street or write to me and all that, said, yes, thank you very much for what you have done. It was the most important course I took in my state. Tell that to the paper pushers. All right. So we said 800,000 Jews perished there. On August 2, 1943, of 700 inmates who revolted, 150-200 got out to escape. Were hunted down, and about 12 survived. In August 1943, in the Bialystok ghetto, 40,000 Jews died. Some managed to escape. On September 1st, 1943, the Jews in the Vilma ghetto in Lithuania, there were a few successful but mostly unsuccessful escapes from camps. Now, moving little bit further, turning the page. One of the last and best reports on that subject of escapes was written by a man called Eric Kulka. It's exceedingly well written, and he's one of the few people who's a survivor witness, and also was a functionary in the concentration camp. And that, I really should say, was very important. Some people had functions because of their political or religious affiliation. So these people helped each other, supported each other. And the more contacts you have, the better network you had in a camp, the higher the chances that you survived because of a net disadvantage, that escape. And so, Five Escapes from Auschwitz, that is the title of his writing. And he writes, and I'm quoting, on April 5, 1944, the prisoner's Siegfried Lederer fled in an SS uniform together with one of the guards of the family camp B2B. B2B was a family camp in Auschwitz, B, Roman 2, small b. He wanted to save her from extermination, which was to take place in June 1944. But René refused to leave her mother. Remember, family camp. Mother, father, all these people could live there once they happened to be there. Therefore, Pestek sought a secure hiding place for himself and the two women where they could evade of the war. A Jewish inmate later saw an opportunity to carry out his plan and offered Pestek the help of his friends in Bohemia, and that is the end of quote. Both men were able to leave Auschwitz in SS uniforms. They obtained masterfully forged documents, and now as SS officer to pick up the two women from the family camp at Birkenau, which was an undertaking, was unbelievably risky. I mean, it was close to a borderline madness for all practical purposes. But they did. First, they went into hiding and then joined the partisans and survived the war. For others inmates, Wetzler, yeah. So now let me just make that a little bit more clear, because what I said is not clear. They apprehended the SS officer while trying to rescue these two women in the family camp, and he was in a train looking out of the window when a group of SS people surrounded that train, and one of the officers recognized the face of Pestek, and immediately they started shooting and all that and apprehended him. And later was able to escape and survive the war. He joined the partisans and survived the war. For other inmates, a man called Alfred Wetzler, Walter Rosenberg, Czeslaw Mordewitz, and Arno Strohlin succeeded to escape from Birkenau and survived also. I almost died because after the escape, later in SS uniform, the entire family camp had to leave their barracks and stand throughout the bitter cold night on the camp road. Because of this ordeal, many died as the consequence of exposure, and I caught pneumonia and pleurisy, had to be hospitalized in the inmate infirmary, where I received minimal but some treatment due to my connections. And Freddy Hirsch came and gave me some unbelievable food, which you only get outside. In freedom. And I still remember that. He came and gave me that food, and it made all the difference. You know, every morsel extra food made a difference. So escape for the successful escape, of course, which included tremendous risk, was a terrific thing for the escapees. But the people who were left behind had to pay for it. And that is, of course, something which most people who wanted to escape didn't think of, because they're primarily people, psychologically and otherwise physical reasons, understandable reasons, with their own safety, their own survival. Now, but this you only could do when you had contacts. Now, how on earth does a general, just a normal, quote-unquote, normal inmate will be able to get a SS uniform? It was virtually impossible. Who shall she sleep? All right, so this is something which we have to remember. So without being streetwise, and without being able to network and have contacts, any of these sort of things were just simply out of the question. Totally out of the question. So the five survived. This is a miracle, but it occurred and has been written down by Eric Kulka. Now, I also survived this sort of ordeal of I had to pay for their successful escape. But I only survived, which I think, because of my genetic makeup. So let's go and talk about the last thing here, and then we'll have a question and answer period. During the German occupation, the native Ukrainian and anti-Jewish fascists distinguished themselves by their eager collaboration with the Nazis and in the massacre of Jews, frequently even outdid their masters, their Nazi masters. In this rare instance, Poles themselves, menaced by these Ukrainians, turned to Jewish partisans for assistance. In this fight against a common enemy, a unity was forged between Poles and Jews, which was most uncommon and exceptional. I will not go into details other than it happened during the winter 93 in the vicinity of the Carpathian Mountains. Carpathian Mountains were either in Poland or in Slovakia. All right, I have still 5 minutes more. Let us now turn to sabotage and resistance in the ghetto of Minsk, which is also quite big. It is important to note that the native Bielorussians. Bielorussians were people, was a republic in the Soviet Union. Belarus, and that was a republic. That the Bielorussian population in the area had feelings of sympathy, very unusual, sympathy, friendship toward the Jews. So, for example, the identity of 60 Jewish children was changed by a Belarusian, Nikolai Romanovich Kashny. He managed to get hold of the register of the Ratomka children's home and changed the designation, quote-unquote, Jew, next to a child. He erased it and wrote, instead, Belarusian of unknown parentage. Without the fraternal help of the Belarusian population, not a single Jew would have survived. These thousands could, because of them, survive. Jew ground leaders of the Minsk ghetto played a significant role in forming a Belarusian organization outside the ghetto, and these two groups worked in close collaboration with each other. The most vital help the Belorussians underground gave the Jews was to assist them to get out of the ghetto to join the partisans. With the help of over 500 Jews, the forest and joined the partisans. The Belorussian underground leaders who believed that the Gestapo was on their trail smuggled themselves into the ghetto. They smuggled themselves in the ghetto where they were hidden by the ghetto underground in secure bunkers. Similarly, Belorussian, this cooperation between the two groups was indeed extraordinary and creative. And they promise. The last thing which I want to mention here, because it has some connection with Minsk, let us look at an assassination, because that I haven't mentioned. Look at an assassination which also took place in Minsk. During the night of 22nd of September 1943, Nazi Colonel Governor of the East, a man called Wilhelm Kube, was blown up by a bomb. David Kamak, a Soviet Jew, who was a parachutist and a deputy commander of the detachment of that region, played a leading role in working out the plans for the assassination. A white Ruthenian, which means, you know, pretty much Belarus, partisan woman, was sent to Minsk with a time bomb, which she passed on to a Miss Halina Mazanik, member of the Minsk underground, who worked as a domestic in Governor Kube's household. She slipped under Kube's bed the bomb and skipped. So there you've got also a case of assassination, which was instigated in this case by a Russian Jew, a yellow, white Russian Jew. So I'm just giving, I had to skip, and that's why it was a little bit rough going, because I had to skip because of time pressure, so that we have a little bit of time left for answer and question period. But the last thing I want to say, which I think is important as far as my feelings are concerned, justifying my presence here. The major reason why I'm involved in the Holocaust Study Center and the lecture series, which, by the way, is a rather thankless and draining work, as you can imagine, is precisely because my responsibility towards those people not died on one hand, and to put it simply, and perhaps also more understandably to you, I don't want our children's and grandchildren's future to be like mine. Just as simple. And that's why I'm sweating blood here, and what I'm doing here is not a very good task. As I said, certainly as far as the administration is concerned, not very recognized it at all, and not very much supported. And some of us who do that, we do it because of a very similar reason I have stated. We have some support from faculty, from colleagues who recognize it, but not in a very strong position to help us very much with it. And so we are actually left to work with the very meager resources available to us, which we as individuals generate one way or another. And it's very important for you to know it, because I don't think all of you can quite appreciate that what we are doing is just another course. It's a lifeline for the future. Thank you very much for this.